my name is Jon Bernard, Superintendent of Schools in North Reading, and I'd like to welcome you to this episode of Inside NRPS. My guests today are Amy Luckiewicz, who is the Director of Youth Services for the Town of North Reading, and also Leah Maihos, who is the Drug-Free Communities Grant Project Coordinator. I'd like to welcome you both, ladies, to the show. Thank you for being here. So I'd like to begin by asking both Amy, who is kind of a long-standing employee of the town now and a bit of a fixture in our community, but I think, Amy, if you wouldn't mind just telling us a little bit about yourself and maybe speak to your background and the work that you do on a daily basis in North Reading.
Sure. So actually, my degree is actually in communications and environmental studies, and I ended up working with children out of college after 9/11. That's kind of how I got into there. I felt like I didn't want to work for ESPN anymore. I wanted to work with kids, and so I started working for the YMCA of Greater Boston, and I worked for them for about 10 years with school-aged children, actually. So I had kids 5 years old through middle school, and my last assignment, I worked in Woburn with, we specialized in children on the autism spectrum. And so I found this position in North Reading, and I thought working with teenagers is something I've always been interested in. My dad taught high school for 40 years. And I thought, let's do a little change. And so I applied here, and I've been here almost 4 years already.
Is it that long?
Yeah.
It does go by quickly.
Very quickly. I love working here. I say this every time, is that I've never been to a community that was more welcoming. Everybody was so friendly, excited about the position. So.
Yeah. We're going to hear a little bit more, I think, in the show today about kind of the day-to-day work that you're doing, but thank you for that. And Leah, you're fairly new to North Reading, so congratulations.
Thank you. Welcome on your
new position. And maybe if you could, for the benefit of our community, just talk a little bit about yourself and what brings you here to this new position.
So I have a master's in social work from Boston University. I recently got last May, and I did a
congratulations.
Couple. Congratulations. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thanks. I did a couple of internships. One was at a hospital, and I worked with a range of different clients and populations, and then I also did one at an elementary school. So I've had quite a bit of range from pediatrics to geriatrics and all stuff in between that I really liked, and I enjoyed working with people. And I've done different roles in social work, and then I kind of just really wanted to move towards more of the policy work, which is what this job's really allowed me to do. And I found it, I've been here since December, and I found it actually right on the town website. I'm a, I live right here in town for the past few years.
Nice.
I found it, and it's been a great fit so far, so I'm excited.
Happy to say I was on the interview committee with Amy that that found you, so
you
certainly did a nice job, obviously.
Thanks.
Here you are.
Yeah,
so.
Thanks.
And as the Drug-Free Communities Grant Project Coordinator, that's a lengthy title, and it's your work, your position is here as the result of a very sizable federal grant that the community of North Reading was fortunate to receive fairly recently. And Amy, you did an awful lot of work, a significant amount of work, on the writing of the extensive grant documents that I had the good fortune of kind of proofreading and contributing
to,
but it was very, very minor compared to the heavy load that you undertook to get this grant of $625,000, am I right, for the community? So,
that's right.
That's a great windfall for this community and for some good work to take place. So before we ask Leah about the specifics of her work, which again is to kind of coordinate the implementation of that grant, I think it might be useful kind of as a segue or a lead-in to hear from you about what that Drug-Free Communities grant entails, what your hopes are for it, and then maybe we can, have a conversation about what where you see it going in the next few years to the benefit of really the entire community. I think, if I'm not mistaken, that's kind of the goal, is that it's a cross section. It's not just focused on any one particular age group. So, can you talk a little bit about what you envision?
Well, we'll start with that topic. Is what age can we work on this for? And so, the Drug-Free Communities program was a very competitive grant. We didn't realize how competitive it was until we've been through our first rounds of training. And every time we go to the federal trainings, they say, "Congratulations," because this one was tough. And it's so tough because it's so important. And they wanted to make sure that it went to coalitions that have been established in a community and who are prepared to take on a workload. So that was why we qualified, mostly, is because we had an existing coalition through the community impact team that was ready to take this on. The specific grant funds cannot be used to work with anybody under the age of over the age of 18. Mm-hmm. However, we really feel like it needs to be a comprehensive program. So although we are not able to use grant funds to work on educational pieces, we have other sponsors and other partners that allow us to do educational programs with seniors, with veterans, everybody across the community. As we know, we're kind of looking at a heroin epidemic, an opiate epidemic in our area, in mm-hmm. our county. And so we're not really seeing under 18s suffer from that as much in this town, but we are seeing drugs, really specifically prescription drugs and marijuana, pop up a lot. And mm-hmm. so we were required to select two drugs to focus on. So we did select marijuana and prescription drugs as the precursor to opiate addiction.
And when you say to focus on, is that through educational initiatives, earlier interventions, that
great question.
That type of thing?
Mostly right now we're focusing on education and policy changes.
Okay.
Yes. So although we're also working on capacity of the coalition, so building that ability. There's a lot of conflicting ideas about both of those things, mm-hmm. about who should have access to those things. I will also add that the grant specifically does identify also tobacco and alcohol are two additional substances that we can focus on, but we had to pick two, really. Mm-hmm. One of the interesting pieces of information that we are looking forward to getting is related to the Pride survey, right, which you've been working with us on collecting that information. We are very excited that this year we're going to ask all students from grades 6 through 12 to mm-hmm. complete the survey, as well as a parent component, mm-hmm. answering four specific questions. And that's past 30-day use in those four different substances, so alcohol, tobacco, marijuana, prescription drugs. Past 30-day use, perception of risk or harm. Do kids think marijuana is harmful? Do parents think marijuana is harmful?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The third one is perception of what their parents think if they ever found out they were using those substances.
Right.
And those answers are things like they would be upset or they wouldn't be surprised at all.
Mm-hmm.
So in that kind of range. And the last one is what do they think their peers would think if they found out they were using? So we're very anxious to get that information back to kind of guide where our information
is. So the intent of this survey is to gather some baseline data. To then mm-hmm. dictate what initiatives we might undertake
Absolutely.
As a community to address the results that the survey
focus
bears.
Our education.
Okay. And that's coming up in March, if I'm not
that's
mistaken,
correct.
Right? Early March at
yep.
both our middle school and our high school.
Yeah, and they've been wonderful partners in getting us ready for that.
And the hope is that we get a significant attendance or participation
yes.
in the survey, while it is optional for students, but we're hoping, and I think my experience in the school department is we typically have a pretty significant response when we ask parents and we ask
they
children to weigh in on mm-hmm. surveys. Anonymous, it's an anonymous survey,
Completely.
So there's another reason why, mm-hmm. I think we bear some honest answers to hard questions
And
sometimes.
We're looking for about 500 parent responses as well.
Great.
Which is, again, all voluntary. And that'll be interesting to see, do the parents feel like alcohol is a big deal in this town?
Mm-hmm.
Or do they think marijuana is a big deal in this town? I will tell you, historically, we found just through kind of focus groups and through the police is that there's been a kind of a casual attitude about drinking specifically.
Yeah.
And now we're seeing that applied to marijuana
mm-hmm.
around the time that things became legalized in our state.
Right.
So that
right.
correlation's been pretty significant. In fact, the federal government has asked us several times, like, how are things going in Massachusetts? Because you're kind of new to the legalization
right,
process.
Right.
So, and having conversations with students, it's been confusing.
Yeah. Yeah, I see it. I see it in the
yeah.
schools. There is a bit of a
mixed
I don't know,
message.
For lack of a bit, that's the phrase I was
yeah.
going to use. There does seem to be a disconnect, a mixed message. Yeah. So, Leah, is it fair to say you started in December? It's my impression, and certainly correct me if I'm wrong, but you've been spending, the last, whatever it is, 8 or so weeks kind of integrating in the community, getting mm-hmm. out to meet people, and we had a very nice introductory meeting back several weeks ago.
Yes.
It appears to me that the administration of this Pride survey, which you did a very nice job presenting to the school committee back
Thank
a few
you.
Weeks ago
Thanks.
To get their approval to survey our students. It's my impression that that's kind of like your first big public initiative. Am I right?
And I'd say so.
And
yes.
it's an important one because we need the data. We need mm-hmm. the data to gather information and see then how do we direct our efforts.
Yeah.
I'm hoping this is an easy question for you, or not too difficult a question, but. What are the hopes, and I'm kind of looking at both of you, like what are the hopes of the impact of the grant and its ability to, ultimately make a positive difference in North Reading? I mean, can you identify, if you could look 5 years out,
sure,
say, and you know, what do we hope for as a community would be different, hopefully in a positive way as a result of the efforts? And you can either one.
Sure.
Yeah.
Well, certainly the aim of the DFC grant is to reduce substance use long term. So
the expectation is there would be further surveys administered, other data collection efforts.
Probably right around
year
4 and 5.
Okay.
To see if there's been an impact and
comparative
how you measure
data.
That. Yeah.
Okay.
We'll also be looking at things like hospitalization rates, arrest arrest data, policy changes. Has anything changed within our town related to ordinances? Those are all sort of measurements. But also to help students prepare to resist or to resist peer pressure, I guess, and to give them the tools that they need to say no when they want to say no, and what do they do next. Also, you know, it's not really funded by the grant, so this is all prevention work, 100% prevention.
It's not treatment.
It's not
right.
treatment, and it's not intervention. And so we want to make sure that we are prepared as a coalition and the community impact team to have that information ready. So although the grant is focused on prevention, the coalition has a little broader scope.
I see. And we're talking about middle school and high school students being surveyed. Are there efforts that you envision being undertaken for younger children as kind of an educational piece as far down as elementary school age children? I mean, is that... Do you see that as being some work
I think that we're going to see that, and we're hoping to enroll a program called Guiding Good Choices. And that's going to be really aimed at parents, grades 3 and up.
Excellent.
And that will be helping them prepare to answer difficult questions, put on appropriate boundaries, what are appropriate consequences for decisions they make, but also building what's called protective factors. Is the community supportive of people going through this?
I see.
Is the community supportive of young parents if they're struggling with an issue with their child and behavior? That's
right.
all part of the package. So this program, Guided Good Choices, will be aimed there versus kind of direct education to younger elementary school students. Might be in years 3 to 4, we'll look down at those programs. There's certainly curriculum out there for that, but that'll be working, of course, with your department to see if that's something that's appropriate for us.
Great. You have a wide... It appears to me a wide network kind of in the community. There's the community impact team, and I think it might be helpful for us at some point today and during this show to talk for the benefit of the community about the community impact team and its makeup and such. But as far as the networking that goes on and kind of the various constituencies that get drawn into this work that you're going to be either doing now or you're going to be continuing to do, are children a part of that network? Are the students, do you meet with students and involve them? Leah, I'm going to look to you.
Yeah. Well, we do have one student right now on the community impact team, and she's a senior, so she'll be leaving at the end of this year or June. So we're hoping to get some more youth on the coalition, and we actually took some youth to D.C. recently.
That's going to be my next question,
okay.
to talk about that experience.
And hopefully maybe they'll have an interest in wanting to join. So we are definitely trying to get some more youth on board, because, you know, they're the ones living the, you know, everyday lives and what we're trying to help them with. So.
And this trip to Washington, D.C. recently, that was, let's see, today we're taping on February 17th. That was, what, last week?
Last week.
So just recently back. So can you talk a little bit about, and Amy, you went with Leah, correct, and 4 high school students?
That's right.
And can you talk a little bit about what was the mission of that work, so to speak?
Sure. Well, one of the big days was Capitol Hill Day, and we actually met with congressmen and senators, and our youth talked to them kind of about what issues they feel are important and if they had any questions they wanted to bring up to them, and especially, too, since they were... they supported the Drug-Free Communities grant in passing that and then also funding. So that was a great opportunity for the youth to kind of talk to them, thank them, and then also ask them their questions related to one of the big laws, which was legalization of marijuana and just how they're going to safely kind of implement those laws, because that is something important that we're looking at. And then aside from that, that was kind of our main focus. But we did a lot of trainings, and there were some seminars, and the youth actually had a whole different portion that they went to as opposed to adults. So, and we could, different days, they had all different talks and speakers.
And these are people from all over the country?
Yeah.
Yeah, national.
National effort, yeah.
Yep.
Wow.
And there are people from the DEA and a bunch of different government organizations, and they were doctors, there were some attorneys, too. And so a lot of people with different specialties all tied into keeping youth away from substance use, and then also just any kind of topics related to substance use. So.
And attendance was a requirement of the grant, am I correct, at this,
for this one?
Institute or a conference?
Not this one. We wanted to do this. Gotcha. We're hoping moving forward we'll be able to continue to pay for the youth to come with us.
I see.
It was fully funded, which is great.
Great.
Do you want to talk about the social media coordinator position too?
Sure, yep. So one of the youth on our coalition right now, she just got hired to be the youth social media coordinator.
Oh, great.
Yeah, and she's posting on Facebook, and I think eventually we'll have a Twitter set up.
Excellent.
So she's just kind of gathering information or things related that she can, you know, reach a broader audience with mm-hmm. the community, since so many people are on social media nowadays.
Right, right.
So.
And when she graduates, we'll lose her for that as
well.
Yeah,
that's what happens. Yeah, try maybe draw them in a little younger.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I know as we met earlier this week to prepare mm-hmm. a little bit for today's taping of the show, you both spoke very highly of the students from North Reading that you brought with you. It was four young ladies, I believe, right? And their preparation and their poise, I guess, if that's the right word, as they interacted with other of their peer group and adults down in Washington, D.C. Do you want to give them a little plug and congratulate them publicly?
Yeah, we had Hannah Lydotes attended. She's our senior. And then we had three sophomores. So Olivia Simon, Abigail Andre, and Emma Valade attended. And I will say they were, without a doubt, the most well-prepared mm-hmm. Of the entire Massachusetts delegation. In fact, when we went to our state meeting, some other coalitions were hoping to split them up so they could use their presentation. We're going to keep those girls together.
Yeah,
and they've been working really hard. Their message was clear. I think it was concise. And they had some really well-developed questions, professional questions, for mm-hmm. the representatives. Mm-hmm. And asking, you know, questions like, how can we affect change and policy and advocacy and funding and, like, things Leah mentioned. I thought it was very well-prepared, robust, and
great.
They were great.
Mm-hmm. And do you envision them having a role further as you embark on implementing the grant? Do you see that you're involving them again?
Yeah, I mean, I think that
continuously, hopefully.
Yeah, I think that would be great if they were interested in doing that.
And their parents.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
You know?
Right.
Yeah, for sure.
That's great. Mm-hmm. And we have something else coming up, am I correct? Another conference that you're going to be attending soon?
Oh, yes.
In San Diego.
This is it's less of a conference, it's more of a course, actually. We actually are required to complete what's called the National Coalition Academy. Both of us will be attending that.
No students. No other folks coming from North Reading, just the two of you.
It's 100% focused on prevention, guided around a couple things. One is the seven strategies for community change, mm-hmm. things like policy change, environmental or physical changes. And the other thing is called the strategic framework of prevention. So we'll be attending 3 weeks, our courses in San Diego, and then we graduate after that. So we go in April, June, and September,
yep.
I think. I think we graduate the following time at the National National Forum.
Nice. Mm-hmm. And that's a requirement.
This
one is a requirement.
They do a really good job of providing training opportunities mm-hmm. for us. You know, prevention is a really broad subject.
Mm-hmm.
Where do you begin? What are the guidelines? What are the logic models behind it? And they provide a lot of resources for us to work through that.
Hmm. There's a lot of excitement around this work. I mean, this community has been, I think, craving an opportunity to, you know, intervene, so to speak, and I mean, this is, you know, to your comments a little bit ago, Amy, you know, about this community being very welcoming of you when you came to work here, and you know, I've worked here a long time now, 14 years, and I feel the same way today as I did back in 2003, but I think that there has been a desire to address some of the kind of social ills that every community faces, and just how do we get our head around that? How do we get people involved? I'd like to go back, if we could, almost kind of coming back to where it all started. And it's my belief that the community, the formation of the community impact team, mm-hmm. which really was the brainchild of our police chief, Mike Murphy, to bring constituencies together, the school department, at the time I was the high school principal when that was formed, but the superintendent sits on the board of directors,
okay.
So I now hold that position with elder services, the board of selectmen, the town administrator, youth services, who am I missing?
Fire chief.
Yep. Board of health, health agent.
We've grown,
for the town. and I think it's my impression that had the community impact team not been formed and in place, that our ability to secure the grant would have been much harder, if not even non-existent.
Possible.
Yeah, right. That's so because that exists and is active, and maybe for the benefit of the community, Amy, you could talk about each of the social service action teams that kind
sure.
of that exist, of which you and I, you serve on a number of them. I only serve on one other one, but the K to, so-called K to 12 action team, which represents kindergarten through grade 12 in our schools. But could you talk a little bit about where you think the community impact team has gotten us and how that continues to evolve as a kind of an agent of change in this community?
Absolutely. And I think it starts with the idea that we can't operate in silos. We can't. If we do that, you know, funding aspect of that is diminished, but also the collaboration and, you know, more ideas just don't happen. And it's really been key to everything. So I was not here at the time of its formation, but from my understanding, it was in response to an increase in opiate overdoses that the town was seeing, not just, well, not just the town, but the, I think the county.
The region, yeah.
The county, for sure. In fact, our county, Middlesex County, has had the most opioid overdose deaths in the state for, I think, 12 years.
Is that right?
So that's not a title that we're very proud
right,
of.
Right.
And so it started with an education piece. And then, you know, through the collaboration, sitting on, you've been in those meetings, and to give people at home an idea of what that's like, is we have really honest conversations about what could we be doing better, how could we be collaborating more, who do we need to speak to at the state and federal level to help us advocate.
Right.
And if though if that opportunity didn't exist, I really feel, I'll speak for myself, I would feel on my own. I don't feel that way here. I feel that we're all pulling the same boat, and that's really important for us. If we continue this, I think it's all of our hopes that we're going to address many quality of life issues. So the action teams, we'll talk about that, and you can speak more to K-12, but there's a social services action team, and the liaison for that is Mary Prenny, who's the elder services director. Rich Wallner and Sue Magner are the co-chairs of that, and they do focus on a little bit of an older population, but really on veterans and seniors. A couple of their initiatives have been around working to make sure that there was a crisis resource guide. That was actually started by that. So if anybody has a crisis resource guide, that's from the CIT. They call it SSAT, Social Services Action Team. But also looking at quality of life and lifelong learning for seniors. Are our veterans being taken care of appropriately? Homelessness and hunger. It's everywhere. You know, they deal with that sort of stuff. Our coalition is an action team. We're mandated by the grant to have at least 12 sectors represented. I can tell you that we have about 25 people, so we're really
great with that.
And then the K-12 action team has been phenomenal with providing education to the community around youth development, I think, in my opinion. You can correct me if I'm wrong, but everything from the developing teenage brain to appropriate consequences and boundaries. I think back to a presentation last year. There was the secret life of the teenager.
Right.
And that was a really well-received presentation. Yeah. And unfortunately, you know, these are things that I don't think every community has the opportunity to present to parents, to the community. But this is not, it goes back to kind of originally what some of the problems are related around substance abuse. It's a stigma. And when people feel like they're on their own, it only makes the problem worse. And so I think moving forward, especially the coalition, will be looking at ways that we can reduce that stigma and say, come out of the shadows and come ask for help, because people are stuck in cycles. And it's tough. Another interesting population that we are looking to address too is grandparents. You know, Mary Prenny from Elder Services talks all the time about some senior issues that she has going on where grandparents are now becoming the primary caregiver again because their adult children are suffering from substance abuse disorders. So that's certainly a population we've identified in North Reading. That's something that we can certainly do better at supporting.
Interesting. A lot of good work going on.
A lot to do.
A lot of good work. And before I give you ladies an opportunity to do any kind of a public service announcement regarding things you might need from the community, I'm going to give a little plug to a couple of programs we have coming up, sponsored by the K-12 action team of the community impact team. We were scheduled to have a program, a presentation, this past Monday, February the 13th, but it's been rescheduled because of the snow event.
Of course.
on April Excuse me.
Yep.
Yeah, April 3rd, right? That's the new date, April 3rd. We have John Morello presenting a program to the community at 6:30 in the Performing Arts Center at the Middle High School. That follows a daytime presentation for junior and senior students, and it's a kind of a positive message around making good choices, an anti-drug message, making kind of good quality of life decisions. I did have the good fortune of seeing John perform his program several years ago at the high school when I was the principal. It's very good. It's a free program to the community, 6:30 p.m. on April the 3rd. If anybody would require additional information about that or would like to learn more about John and his program, I would urge them to contact the superintendent's office, and I'd be happy to share some information about that. I have been sending that out kind of school district-wide through my email connections, but that may not reach community members who don't have children in school.
And it's open to everybody.
It's open to everyone. It absolutely is. And again, a free program. We have our kind of North Reading night off. I believe it's our third event.
Yeah.
Right? I think on March the 14th. So we're kind of all hoping the community can kind of take a breath, take a step back and just relax on Tuesday evening, March the 14th. No evening events scheduled. We're doing some restaurant promotions through the generosity of local restaurants. We're asking teachers in the schools to relax homework requirements to the extent that they can.
And the kids are very happy about that.
I'm sure they are. I'm sure it's unfortunate that it's only one night, but really just an opportunity for families to reconnect. And I think our third program scheduled for, am I correct, May the 8th, is
that
it?
Sounds right with
Ruth
Dr.
Pody.
Yep.
Yeah, kind of that's a teen-tween brain development. She's a physician. I have not seen her perform, but she was recommended to me from a local superintendent, Superintendent in Linfield, who had Dr. Pody present this past October. So that, too, is a free event in the Performing Arts Center at the Middle High School, 6:30 p.m. And again, I think that's May 8th. So, so a lot of good work going on, and you two are both doing some very good and important, really vitally important work in my opinion. I have the good fortune of working with young people, have done it for a long time, and I see firsthand the challenges that young people face. You know, I make comments about, I think it's hard to be a good kid today, and we have a lot of good kids. We really do. So many good kids in North Reading, but there are some things out there that really, I think, compromise their abilities to be, the best people that they can be across the board for all of them. And I think the work that you're doing, Amy, I have a tremendous amount of respect for the work you've done the last several years that I've had the good fortune of working with you. And it's making a difference. And Leah, you're coming into a situation of a community that really, I think, cares about its young people. Mm-hmm. And, I think that gets demonstrated to them pretty consistently. Mm-hmm. I've always felt as though our young people, our students, our kids respond very well to that. I think they know, I'd like to believe that they know that people in this community care about them. And mm-hmm. and because of that, I think we get a lot back from them, whether it's volunteer work or just, doing good things, staying involved in their schools, in their communities, in their churches. It's a good thing, but I think it needs like kind of the constant vigilance. And it needs people to be involved. And I know that you both would like to see more people involved, am I right?
So absolutely.
If you'd like to invite the community, now's a good opportunity for you to get a word out there on what you might need in terms of volunteerism.
Mm-hmm. Want to talk about the coalition?
Sure. So we have the Community Impact Team Coalition. We have a broad range of different people on it. And we've been doing some activities that are engaging other businesses in town and maybe getting the word out around stuff that we're doing. So it's always great to have people participating and helping and volunteering, and then also helping with those kind of community efforts and projects we're working on. So we're always welcoming new people.
And how would someone get involved? How would they contact you directly, Leah?
Yes, I would say, we have the youth services information on the town website.
Okay.
So I would say that would probably be the best
way. Our email coalition@northreadingma.gov.
The email is coalition@northreadingma.gov. So if somebody sends an email to that and expresses their desire to become involved, someone will get back to them.
Yeah.
That's great. Well, congratulations to you in your new position. Amy, congratulations and thank you for the good work.
Thank you. May I add one more invitation?
Absolutely.
All right. I just want to, you know, make sure that everybody out there knows that although we're focused on youth prevention, that if anybody out there needs any help with getting intervention and treatment, that they can also reach out to us, and we're going to make sure that that happens. It's very difficult to navigate the treatment programs in the state. It is tough. We understand that, and they're not alone. Please contact us, and we'll make sure that we can do the best we can to get treatment.
That's an important message. I'm glad you got that in.
Sure.
Thank you both for being here today.
Thanks.
Thank you for the good work, and thank you for joining us
today.
Thank you.
Thank you.